Hello.
I'm gonna turn this over to Caitlin, who's the president of Students for Social Justice. And I want you guys to all feel welcome, and I want you to be able to quietly get up and help yourselves if the food is ready to be eaten. But I also want to make sure that we have a presence so that we can hear all the talking and because that's probably part of the point of being here. So this is Caitlin McCoy, she's the president of Students for Social Justice. And thanks for coming out to
Awesome. So tonight we are doing a couple of events. First of all, we are going to have the lovely Vita Flores come to talk to us about our state propositions and the impact of civic engagement. We will also have a speaker, Connor Johnston, to speak about the propositions. And we will be doing proposition trivia and Jeopardy for prizes, so you can win. So be sure to stick around for that. As Susan said, we've got pizza, we've got mozzarella sticks, we've got salad, sodas, and fruit. Feel free to help yourself to any of that. And I hope you guys have a great time. Thank you so much for coming out.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Vita Flores, and I'm with the League of Women Voters, and I'm also with the Marin County Elections Department. My job is to outreach to you and your group. So I have a wonderful YouTube video that I want to show first. And this is from Wendy Romero, and she's the founder of the Center for Civic Engagement at UC Davis. And she gave a TED Talk, and I thought it would be fun to start out. So as you eat, you can pick up your food and eat, and then we'll start the video.
The UC Davis pepper spray incident.
And yes, it should always be discussed and it should never be forgotten. So you might ask me, what does voting have to do with social change and social movement? A lot. So we have a very long history in the United States of denying the right to vote. Not to everyone, just to some people, certain groups, and very often with the express purpose of denying their voice, their needs, their desires for social change. Often violently, and young people have taken the brunt of this. So some examples of fighting for the right to vote, women's suffrage, the Voting Rights Act, and lowering the minimum voting age from 21 to 18. If you could fight and die for your country in Vietnam, didn't you have the right to vote on that war? Or so young people said, 18-year-olds said, and they eventually did get that right, but not until the war was nearly over. Let me ask all of you here, how many of you voted in the most recent statewide election, November 2014? Raise your hands if you voted. Raise them high. Okay. A decent number. I'm a political sociologist, and I do research on voting behavior. I founded and direct the California Civic Engagement Project here at UC Davis. And we know from much research in the field that young people, at least in the 20th and 21st centuries, have voted, particularly those aged 18 to 24, in much lower numbers than older age groups, some 20, 30, 40 percentage points lower, depending on the election. Now, I study the youth vote nationally and in California. I'll share some numbers around my research in California. So think for a moment. What do you think the eligible turnout rate was for 18 to 24-year-olds last November here in California? That would be the percentage of those who are eligible to vote, if it's eligible, whether they're registered or not. What percentage actually voted? Think, and I'm going to show you. Yeah. 8%. This turnout rate, even lower for youth of color, even lower for youth from low-income backgrounds. This meant that out of the 3.5 million eligible 18 to 24-year-olds in California, only 285,000 actually voted. So low turnout leaves young people very underrepresented at the ballot box in any election, but this last election in California, that low turnout rate meant that they were 3.9% of all voters. That's all. But they're 14.5% of the eligible voter population. So they're numerically very underrepresented because obviously there's a big gap between those two numbers. So severe underrepresentation for young people at the ballot box has very real consequences for the issues they care about, for policy. Let me ask you, do you hear whatever your age is, do you hear politicians, candidates, campaigns talking about the issues that young people care about? Probably not so much. Now, this presidential season, we're hearing more about the issues that young people care about. But overall, not so much, especially if you look at the state level or local races, very few. Why is that? Pretty simple. Politicians know who vote, and they know who don't vote. And the issues of older voters are the issues that dominate our political landscape. Older voters, of course, vote in much larger numbers. Now, of course, there are issues that overlap that across age groups that older and younger voters agree on. But the issues that younger folks tend to prioritize, and certainly the full array, the full spectrum of issues they care about, are not discussed in our political landscape. Here's the kicker. Young people, those aged 18 to 24, are actually more numerous in our population than older voters, older age groups. So if we eliminated disparities in the turnout, and everybody voted the same across ages, those aged 18 to 24 would actually be a larger share of all voters. So for instance, standing at 3.9% that they were in November 2014, and by the way, those aged 65 to 74, that's the age group with the highest turnout rate, they were 12% of the vote. We see these flipped. The young people would have been 14.5% of all voters. So you bet that if this had happened and if this were consistent across elections, the issues young people care about, the youth vote, period, would be courted, would be aggressively mobilized, right? Gone after, fought after. Now, would it change everything on the political landscape? No, but there would be change. So, if young people are, well, they care very deeply about issues, and if they're more numerous, right, they have the power in numbers to affect change on the things they care about for their communities, then why don't we see more young people voting? Well, our civic structures, our political system more broadly, as it's designed, produces non-voters amongst young people, leaving their voice not heard and leaving them not able to fully realize the power of the ballot box. How? One, we have an abysmal civic education system here in the U.S. One that has been systematically defunded by all accounts for decades. We gave young people the right to vote, 18-year-olds, in 1971, but then we systematically defunded their civics education after that. Two, rules and regulations around our electoral system, around getting access to voting. We know from much research, disproportionately disadvantages young people. Registration, for instance, the fact that you have to register before you can vote. Elements of registration, like the fact that it's tied to an address. Young people are highly mobile. They move, they lose their registration, they lose their ability to vote. Three, young people get very little outreach and mobilization on campaigns and candidates. Those are still the way our system is designed, we are still the agents that do most of the mobilization and outreach in our political system. They see young voters as not likely voters, young people as not likely voters. They don't jump to them in any given election, young people again don't vote, and the vicious cycle continues. And then, more broadly, thinking at a societal level, our culture discourages, or at least certainly doesn't encourage in any sincere way young people to vote. It is completely socially acceptable in the U.S. for a young person or young people not to vote. And there are many negative attitudes about young people in voting. If you listen, so in my research, I hear often from older voters that will say, well, maybe it's not such a bad thing, or maybe it's a very good thing that a young person isn't voting. Wait till they get a little bit more knowledgeable, get a stake in the game, start paying taxes. I'm not so sure I want the young person making a decision for me in my pocketbook. By the way, statistically, all of you in this room are far more informed than the average U.S. voter. And because of things like rising tuition costs, the students among you are working far too many hours. You are paying taxes now. You have a stake in the game. Now, not just later. And then we hear young people taking on these negative attitudes and saying themselves, well, I'm not sure if I'm informed enough, I don't know if I know enough about the issues to vote right now, to make a good decision, maybe I'll wait till I get older. And all of these factors come together and leave young people politically powerless, at least at the ballot box. And they deserve to leave young people feeling politically disconnected from the political process, thinking that their vote doesn't matter, that politicians and candidates and campaigns don't care about what they think. And how in the world could voting be an actionable step on the issues I care about? So let's go back to issues. I know that for many of you here in this room, the issues you care about are directly connected to the communities that you're from. And for many of you, the communities that you're from themselves feel politically disconnected. I'm from one of those communities as well. I was raised here in the Central Valley in California. And as I was growing up, I saw all around me communities, including my own, where people that are living and weren't doing so well. Poverty, poor educational outcomes, poor access to healthcare, many disadvantages. And as I grew up, I realized that people in those communities didn't vote. My own parents didn't vote. And the young people voted least of all. And it left the people in those communities, the residents, without a voice, and not able to have influence on the decisions that were being made for them. So, I became driven to find out why this was. So my pathway to social change, became a researcher. And to study and to learn about the mechanisms that are at play that produce melanoma, right, that limit people's voices. Now, I'm a researcher now, and I educate, and I hopefully also, my work leads to affecting change and leading to solutions. But I know that for all of you here in this room, there will be many, many different pathways, usually not research, that you'll take to realize change or affect change on the issues you care about. But one thing that you can do now is that you can vote as an individual, but you also can be a spark for a social movement around voting. When young people come together, when they do come together in big numbers, it can be very powerful. They come together in big numbers for voting. For example, 2008, electing the first African-American president. These vote had a lot to do with that. In 2012, here in California, Proposition 30 passed a tax that provided desperately needed educational funding for K-12 and college. Young people came out in big numbers, and they helped get that passed. So what can you do? There's lots of things you can do. But one thing you can do is to make sure you register to vote. If you're not registered, get registered.
I'm going to stop that right here because I want to shame this plug. If you're not registered, we can register you right now tonight. Today is the deadline. And we can do it online before anytime. And you can be registered to vote. So this whole idea of civic engagement and all of the things that we're going to be talking about tonight mean that you get to play a part. But you only can play a part if you're registered to vote. So Caitlin's going to introduce our speaker, our first speaker, and then
Hi again. So I'd like to welcome Connor Johnston, who grew up in Marin. He took courses at College of Marin, mainly in our automotive program, attended high school at San Ignatius in San Francisco, and has his degree from UCLA. Currently serves as the Chief of Staff for London Breed, who is the President of the San Francisco Board of Supervisors. He is an expert in public policy, and most recently helped author the grant on Styrofoam in San Francisco. Please help me welcome Connor.
Hello everybody. Can everyone hear me? I'm going to do this without a microphone, if that's okay. I have a list of the 17 statewide ballot measures that we get to contend with in November. I'll just pass these around so we can kind of keep track of what we're talking about. How much time do we have?
What do you want? Like 45 minutes? Does that sound good? Hour?
Take 45 minutes for 17 of them, we'll have a little less than 3 minutes per. So we can cover all of them, I can go in numerical order, or we can kind of pick off the exciting ones first. Does anyone have a preference?
Exciting ones first,
all right. Let's bang out a couple of the ones that are on the same topic. Just briefly, 62 abolishes the death penalty, 66 says let's put more people to death. And let me skip ahead my notes on those, because these ones pretty quickly. 62 ends the death penalty in California and replaces it with life imprisonment without the possibility of parole. It applies retroactively to existing death sentences. There's quite a few of those down the street at San Quentin. And the fiscal impact of the state is estimated to be about $150 million per year if we get rid of the death penalty. If you don't like the death penalty, 62 is an obvious yes. Do might be interested in 66, which decides to reform the appeals process rather than getting rid of the death penalty. It changes the procedures governing state court challenges to death sentences. It designates the Superior Court for initial petitions and limits successive petitions. So you know, a lot of times the reason someone's on death row for 25 years is because there's a series of petitions. My lawyer had a bad haircut, they didn't provide this evidence. Whatever it may be, these go on for years and years. So 66 would diminish a lot of those appeal opportunities and presumably speed up the process. The fiscal impact is unknown because it's difficult to determine how exactly that would play out. So that's 62 and 66. Those are pretty straightforward. Do you support the death penalty or don't you? The next two that are related to each other, and stop me if you have any questions on any of these. But I'm going to go pretty quickly in the interest of time. The next two that are related to each other were actually both put on the ballot by out-of-state plastic bag manufacturers, and those are 65 and 67. I'm going to start with 67 because as soon as I turn there, I swear I'll have a reason. In 2014, the California legislature passed a statewide ban on carry-out plastic bags. So I think Marin has had one of those for 8 years, something like that. San Francisco was one of the first cities in the state to do it. So that means when you go to the grocery store, they give you a paper bag, or you're expected to use a reusable bag. And if you get a paper bag, they typically charge you for it. So that started locally. It started in San Francisco and ran in municipalities around the state. It then went statewide, it became state law with SB 270 in Sacramento. When SB 270 passed, these plastic bag companies exercised the initiative process, which allows them to hold a referendum election on a state law that is passed. So that delayed the implementation of the statewide ban for, I think it's been about 18 months, until this thing could go to the ballot. And what that means is, if you vote yes, you are approving 67. You are approving the statewide ban, so SB 270. If you vote no, you are rejecting the statewide ban, SB 270. So if you want to get rid of the disposable plastic bags, that would be a yes vote. If you want to keep disposable plastic bags, that would be a no vote. Let's see, is there anything else of interest here? The fiscal impact is relatively small. The organizations and entities that support this proposition, it's kind of a wide range of environmentalists, coastal advocates. The grocers, I think, have stayed neutral on this, but I could be wrong. And then the people who are opposed to it, people who want to see us get rid of the plastic bag ban, a group called the California Manufacturers and Technology Association, the California Republican Party, the California Taxpayer Protection Committee, and although they don't want to say this very loudly, the companies that make plastic bags are also against the ban, which is shocking. So that's 67. 65 was put on for similar reasons by similar entities. It's a little bit different though. Currently under the law, if you get a paper bag, the grocer charges you 10 cents for that bag. That money actually stays with the grocer. And if I can editorialize a little bit based on my own experience, part of that is to enhance the coalition of groups that supported these laws in the first place. So the grocers were very concerned that if we can't get bags out anymore, people aren't going to buy as much. They're only going to buy as much as they can stuff in their pockets and carry out the store. And also, the plastic bags were cheaper, the paper bags were more expensive. So one of the ways that the coalition supporting these plastic bag bans was able to coalesce is by providing this fee structure and helping to incent the grocers' participation and enthusiasm. What 65 does is it says that 10 cents per bag can no longer go to the grocers. It has to go to an unnamed and as yet ill-defined environmental purpose. It is also put on by the plastic bag manufacturers. And in terms of support and oppose, it's very similar to 67. You have seen a little bit less opposition to this one from environmental groups and the people who are really enthusiastic about 67. For example, the California Democratic Party, which supports 67, took no position on 65. I don't really know why, but I think this one is maybe just a little bit more delicate. And again, editorializing a bit here, part of the intent of something like this is A, to muddle the issue for voters, and B, to divide the coalition of people who support the plastic bag ban in the first place. So that's sort of the intent behind 65. I probably editorialized it too much, but I've done a lot of work on this type of waste reduction stuff, so maybe I take it personally. And then 67 is a pretty straight up yes or no. Do you support the plastic bag ban or do you not? So those are 65 and 67. Those are really the only sets of two that are sort of companion measures. From here we can go to the sex, drugs, and guns, if people are interested in those. Or I should stop and see if there are any questions on plastic bags or the death penalty. Savings by abolishing it. Yeah, death penalty cases are very expensive, in part because of all those appeals, the years and years, and solitary confinement, et cetera. Yes, ma'am?
Never mind, it's more of an education.
It's more of a what? All right. How about marijuana? Should we do that? 64? All right. So just briefly, because this thing does a lot, actually. It's a little bit more complicated than what otherwise appeared. It legalizes marijuana for adults 21 years or older, so similar to alcohol, and actually now tobacco too. It designates specific state agencies to license and regulate the marijuana industry, and there are actually quite a few. The Department of Health can regulate certain things, and blah, blah, blah. There's a bunch of different departments involved. It imposes a state excise tax of 15% on retail sale of marijuana and a state cultivation tax of $9.25 per ounce of flowers and $2.75 per ounce of leaves. And I don't have enough empirical experience with marijuana to know the equal distinction there, but it's a lot of money. It exempts medical marijuana, which is currently legal under state law already, from some of these taxation measures. It establishes packaging, labeling, advertising, and marketing standards. It prohibits marketing to minors, which is similar to what we have with tobacco and alcohol. It allows for local regulation and taxation, so local municipalities can actually say, we don't want any marijuana vendors in our city or in the county. It provides for some measure of local control in that respect. And it authorizes resentencing and destruction of records for prior marijuana convictions. So if you were previously arrested for carrying something that is now deemed legal, that conviction would be expunged from your record. The fiscal impact is estimated to be in the high hundreds of millions of dollars to over $1 billion annually. Put that in perspective. Does anyone know the size of California's state budget? Roughly. Amen? No. Just California. It's California state government's budget. Bigger than most, actually bigger than the vast majority of countries. It's around $122 billion, give or take. I think we're now the sixth or seventh largest economy in the world. Bigger than a lot of big countries. And obviously these, a lot of, in addition to the revenue that would be generated on the taxation side, there would also be reduced costs on the criminal justice, imprisonment, trial side. So you're sort of making money and saving money. The list, yes ma'am. Questions on marijuana? No? Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, can I go back to the death penalty real quick?
I figured you would.
Was the 150 in savings, was that counted against the extra cost to keep people in the prison for life?
That's net savings. So people who are currently sentenced to death are going to be in prison for duration of their life under the current system. And that imprisonment and those court cases are going to be significantly more expensive than just putting them in prison for life from the outset. So it's a net savings.
I had a question.
Yes, sir.
When you put regulations on roads, do you have licenses on roads?
Yeah, there's quite a bit of, and I'm actually in the process of reading the full language, it's pretty long. There's quite a bit of licensing, registration that happens under the auspices of a few different departments. So there'd be a license to be a commercial distributor, a license for growing, a license for retail. And they've also put in place controls on the sizes of some of the growing operations, that even more of a small mom and pop type growing business. Because I think there's concern about the tobacco industry or somebody else coming in and somebody else monopolizing the industry. So yeah, it's a surprisingly complex measure. And I don't mean that pejoratively. It's surprisingly robust in the regulation process and provisions. Let's go to guns and then sex. Good night out. 63, bouncing around. 63 was largely spearheaded by Gavin Newsom, our lieutenant governor. For some reason, I put this in really small font, so bear with me. It requires background check and Department of Justice authorization to purchase ammunition. So currently, you need that to purchase a gun. You would now need it for the ammunition to use the gun. It prohibits the possession of large capacity ammunition magazines. And I think you're actually required to surrender ones if you already own them. It establishes procedures for enforcing laws prohibiting firearm possession by specified persons, which is a complicated way of saying it establishes a framework to prohibit certain people, whether they're on the no-fly list or have previous domestic violence cases or whatever it may be. It establishes a process for prohibiting those people from owning guns. It requires the Department of Justice's participation in the federal National Instant Criminal Background Check System, so that the State Department of Justice could do instant background checks for people who are looking to purchase a gun. In terms of fiscal impact, we are estimating increased state and local court and law enforcement costs, potentially in tens of millions of dollars per year. Tens of millions of dollars to take away there. Related to some new court processes, and probably background checks, et cetera, et cetera. Newsom has been, as I said, one of the chief promoters of this, and I think there were some people who weren't particularly excited about that because there were people working on this legislatively in Sacramento, and he just sort of took the issue and took it to the voters directly. And that may have ruffled some feathers. This is kind of neither here nor there, but it's sort of an interesting backstory. The thing about gun control, particularly in San Francisco, this has been the case, but probably statewide as well, is that it's not really an issue of voters choosing one way or the other. The voters, certainly in San Francisco, but probably in California, are pretty well decided on a lot of these issues. And what ultimately becomes the deciding factor is how the courts interpret those laws that they pass vis-a-vis the Second Amendment. So San Francisco a few years ago passed a law, the ballot, the voters passed it, saying you couldn't own a gun in San Francisco. Somebody immediately sued and got thrown out of court. And that is often the conflict that we see. It's not so much the dynamic that you see at the national level, where there's roughly equal constituencies who support gun control and oppose on the voting side. What we see here is more of a pretty strong constituency that supports measures like this, but a judiciary that sometimes has to back those off for their constitutional reasons. Okay. So, all of that said, it's kind of a long way of saying that you see a long list of proponents of this. Gavin Newsom, Dianne Feinstein, the Law Center to Prevent Gun Violence, the California Democratic Party, Secretary of State Alex Padilla, two of the former speakers of the Assembly, Tony Atkins and John Perez, Sheriff Vicki Hennessy in San Francisco, SEIU, the Service Employees International Union, the League of Women Voters, the California Young Democrats, the California Federation of Teachers, a whole laundry list of other groups I'm not going to read. Rabbis Against Gun Violence, States United to Prevent Gun Violence, a long list of people. The con list is a little bit smaller. The president of the California State Sheriff's Association, the CEO of the California Reserve Peace Officers Association, Coalition for Civil Liberties, U.S. Special Operations Command Anti-Terrorism Instructor, that was actually an individual, a former spokesman at the United Nations, the California Republican Party, and I'm doing the con side a little bit of this service. There's a longer list. It's essentially law enforcement, more conservative groups, the type of people who typically stand up for Second Amendment rights would be on the con side. You certainly see a very long list of people on the pro side as well. So that's 63. Fundamentally what it does is provide a lot of the same restrictions on gun purchasing and gun ownership to the actual ammunition. Let's do 60, the comments and more. Any questions on ammunition? Yes, sir.
Would it require any military members that were just in the military to go through the same background checks?
Probably, yeah, I don't know. Probably. I mean, if you're not on active duty anymore, it's, I don't know. If you're on active duty, I imagine so. Okay, 60 is an interesting one. So, 60 requires adult performers to use condoms during the filming of sexual intercourse. It requires porn producers to pay for performer vaccinations, testing, and medical examinations. And it requires producers to post condom requirements at the filming sites. In terms of fiscal impact, there is likely to be a reduction of state and local tax revenues of several million dollars annually. I think that's because they anticipate that this would force a lot of the production companies out of the San Fernando Valley, which is where many of them operate, and out of state, to Nevada, Arizona. And an increased state spending of about $1 million annually on regulation, which they anticipate will be partly offset by new fees. So relatively small in terms of the fiscal impact side. California is actually the leading adult film industry location. Of all the 50 states of the union, California has the most, largely in San Fernando Valley, outside of LA. And the interesting thing, I did not know this, Cal OSHA, which is the Occupational Safety and Health Agency Administration, one of those, they enforce workplace safety standards. Cal OSHA actually already requires condom use in adult films. They generally enforce these rules by responding to complaints, and in 2014 and 2015, they cited exactly 4 production companies. So, reading between the lines, I suspect this is not something that's really high on the enforcement priority list. And actually, Los Angeles County already specifically requires adult film condom use. They passed a Measure B in November 12 that requires it. And again, I suspect Los Angeles County is probably not putting a ton of resources into enforcing this. Prop 60 clarifies Cal OSHA's existing rule by adding a requirement to the California Labor Code, so I think it becomes a bit more codified. It requires adult film producers to be licensed. It expands the time frame for enforcement, so I think currently you can only pursue an enforcement action if the violation happened in the last 6 months. Under this, it would be like a year or two. It makes the distributors and agents of the porn potentially liable for violations. And this is the interesting one. It has what's called a private right of action, PRA, in the business, that allows any California resident to sue, conceivably, any porn star or any porn production or distribution company. So you could actually bring suit against the porn star for not using a condom or for appearing in a video where a condom is not used. And then there's some language that if you prevail in that case, you're actually entitled to your attorney's fees plus a little bit more, so you go into business suing porn stars. Interestingly, both 60 and 61 were put on the ballot by a guy named Michael Weinstein of the AIDS Health Foundation. And I'll talk about him a little bit more with respect to 61, but it's an interesting side point that we'll get to in a second. And Cal OSHA actually considers the exposure to certain bodily fluids as a workplace hazard, which begs the question, if you start bringing porn under the rubric of traditional workplace hazard regulations, Does that mean that people have to wear latex gloves and those dental shields that your dentist wears when you're getting a root canal in addition to the condoms? Presumably, yes. I mean, if you're in a different job and subjected to bodily fluids, those would probably be required and could potentially be required now for porn, which I'm sure is a fetish that is going to satisfy somebody, but probably not the broader audience. And so what we will probably see is porn going more underground than out of state. In terms of the pro side, so these are people who want condoms to be required more explicitly and enforced more emphatically. The board chair of the AIDS Healthcare Foundation, and that is actually Mr. Weinstein himself, the former director of the Los Angeles County Sexually Transmitted Disease Program, an HIV-positive former porn star, a professor at UCLA School of Medicine, the director of UCLA's Program on Population and Reproductive Health, and the founder of International Entertainment Adult Union. I think that is a union of adult film workers. I should stop calling them porn stars. Technically, it's adult film workers. On the con side, the president of the Adult Performer Advocacy Committee, the former chair of Cal OSHA, and she signed on to the OPPOSE, Marie Louise Nina Hartley Levine, who actually apparently has a Bachelor of Science in Nursing. Nina Hartley is, I think, a well-known porn actress. Mark Leno, the state senator in San Francisco, who's about to be termed out. A doctor of internal medicine signed on. The vice president of the Valley Industry and Commerce Association. If anyone would like to hazard a guess why the Valley Industry and Commerce Association is interested in this one, because they make a lot of money from porn being filmed in the Valley. The California Republican Party is against this. The California Democratic Party is against this. A lot of the lead LGBT organizations like Equality California are against it. And a lot of newspapers, including the San Francisco Chronicle. So that is comments and porn. Any questions on that? Yes, ma'am.
So one of the things that I've been reading about in regards to this online is that part of the results of this passing would be to compile a database of the actors who actually participated in it to sort of keep their test results current and whatnot. And there's no word as to how secure that database would be and whether or not their identities would be at risk to be hacked by people. Because this is people in an industry where they're prone to attract a lot of stalkers and unlike people. And that is a safety issue for them. And I don't understand why no one's addressing that.
That's an interesting point. Okay, let's go to 61, the prescription drug price one, because it was put on, and by the way, when I say put on, what I mean is that somebody financed the process of going out and collecting enough signatures to qualify a measure for a ballot. So some measures will come from the state legislature, the assembly and senate pass it, it goes on the ballot. They pass it intentionally to go on the ballot. Some measures come because somebody organized an effort to gather enough signatures to qualify. So when I say put on the ballot, in this case, Michael Weinstein financed the process of collecting signatures to put 60 and 61 on the ballot. And 61 prohibits the state from buying any prescription drug from a drug manufacturer at a price higher than the lowest price paid for that drug by the United States Department of Veteran Affairs. So that's the Federal Veteran Affairs. It exempts managed care programs funded through Medi-Cal. And in terms of the fiscal impact, the states could potentially save an unknown amount depending on how this thing is implemented and how the drug companies respond. I'll get back to that point in a second. So this is sort of fun. Anyone want to hazard a guess at how much the state spends on prescription drugs every year? Total budget's 120, give or take, billion. How much do you think we spend on prescription drugs? Did you say, what was that?
6 billion.
Very close. It was 3.8 in 2014-2015. 3.8 billion. It's just a significant portion of the budget. Different payers often pay different prices for the same prescription drug. So the VA may pay a certain price, Medi-Cal may pay a certain price, your private insurance company may pay a different price, and if you're uninsured and go to buy it just at retail price, you're probably going to pay a different, significantly higher price. And often those prices are confidential. So what the VA is paying may not be known to anyone else, or Medi-Cal is paying may not be known to anyone else. This measure sets a cap on how much the state can pay for prescription drugs, And that cap is how much the VA is paying. Challenge is, we may not know what the VA is paying, which makes the implementation of this law very difficult and makes interpreting how this may play out very difficult. For one thing, Prop 61 regulates what the state does. It says the state cannot pay more than what the VA pays. It does not, however, mandate or require the drug companies to do or not do anything. So the drug manufacturers might just not offer their drugs at that price. They might not disclose the price that they're giving to the VA, or may not sell it in California at all. It's difficult to anticipate how that will play out, how those companies will react. But we're putting a mandate on ourselves, is important to remember, not on the companies we would potentially be doing business with. Again, this was put on by Michael Weinstein at the AIDS Healthcare Foundation. A little bit of a backstory on him. Anybody familiar with the HIV prevention drug PrEP? It's a revolutionary drug that is highly effective in preventing the transmission of HIV if it's taken properly and used properly. Michael Weinstein is against PrEP. He's come out very publicly attacking it, calls it a party drug. It's caused quite a bit of controversy and schism within the LGBT community. And he is regarded in a lot of circles as something of a pride, in large part for those efforts to discredit and discount PrEP. So what you see with 61 is a very engaged and animated opposition from a lot of LGBT groups. And that includes, where is my list of those? Equality California, a couple of the big groups in San Francisco, Alice Tobolus, the Harvey Milk Club, but then also in opposition, you see a lot of veterans groups, because veterans groups are concerned that in order for the drug companies to be able to sell their drugs at the price they want to California, rather than lowering them on that side, they're just going to raise them on the VA side, which is possible. So you see the president of the Vietnam Veterans of America, California State Council, signed on in opposition. The Veterans of Foreign Wars in California signed on. And then you also have some health providers. So the California Hepatitis C Task Force, the California Association of Rural Health Clinics, the vice chair of the Latino Diabetes Association, also in opposition, the California Republican Party, the San Francisco Chronicle, the California NAACP, and interestingly, the California Democratic Party did not take a position. I could speculate why that is, but I honestly don't know. On the pro side, the California Nurses Association, the state director of AARP, the Association of American Retired People, former state senator Art Torres, the AIDS Healthcare Foundation, that's Michael Weinstein's group, the chair of the California Democratic Party Veterans Caucus, so you see a little bit of disagreement among the veterans community there, and the Los Angeles Urban League, / California Association of Urban Leagues. So 61 is an interesting one. Obviously, the drug manufacturers are putting quite a bit of money into opposing it. There is the schism in the LGBT community, as I mentioned. And then a lot of people who are sort of staying out of it. In the California Democratic Party, probably the most noteworthy of those. That is 61. Any questions on that? Yes, ma'am. The fiscal impact analysis says we don't really know. That's true. I think we do know that we are setting a cap on what we as a state do that is dependent on information we may not necessarily have, and that requires a second party who may not necessarily be willing to participate. So in that sense, yes, it's difficult to anticipate how that plays out.
Assuming that the VA gets a low price, just for argument's sake, can the companies raise the price they charge the VA in response to this?
Those are negotiated with the VA, which has enormous buying power. It's a federal agency. If it's as big as California is, the VA is bigger. It's possible. I doubt it's something they could just around with one of those rice bags stickers and raise it, but there could potentially be that upward pressure for them to say, we're going to have to charge the VA more in order to not lose our shirt in California. That language might be a little different in order to not make it much. Okay, we're doing pretty well on time, so why don't I ask if anybody is interested in a particular one? I should probably use cigarettes, but does anybody want to do any particular one that we have left? Well, 51 through 59.
59?
All right, 59 is a quick one. These kind of things are very popular at the Board of Supervisors in San Francisco, where I work. We call these non-binding resolutions. It basically means we are expressing an opinion that doesn't actually do anything, it has no legal impact, but it's an expression of an opinion. So what 59 says is that California's legislative leaders should seek an amendment to the United States Constitution to overturn the Citizens United Use. Now, Citizens United is a Supreme Court case, a federal Supreme Court case, from a few years ago that essentially said you cannot place limits on certain political spending by corporations and unions. That corporations and unions are allowed to spend as much money in elections as they want. I think the premise was that they are legally individuals and that you are abridging their First Amendment rights by putting limits on the amount of money they can spend, because spending money in an election is a form of speech. That was the logic behind Citizens United. It's obviously been extremely controversial since then. So what 59 says is essentially California is on record saying we want a federal amendment to the Constitution to overturn Citizens United. Now, it is entirely possible that the composition of the federal Supreme Court will change and Citizens United could be overturned in a later Supreme Court case. That's frankly probably more likely a path to overturning Citizens United than pursuing an amendment to the Constitution, which requires three-fourths of the states to approve it. That's probably a much more difficult path. I'm sure it was two-thirds of the people. It's been a long time. Too much time working in local government. This one was put on by the California legislature. So I mentioned before that some measures are put on by collective votes. Some measures the California legislature, our assembly and senate, says we're going to put this on the ballot ourselves. And there are different reasons why they might do that. In this case, I will editorialize for you and say, I suspect they put this on to boost voter turnout among more Democratic-leaning constituencies. Because Citizens United is a red-hot issue among a lot of people, particularly, I think, more the Bernie Sanders crowd. So by the California Democratic legislative leaders putting this on the ballot, the idea may have been, this will help drive turnout to support our other candidates on the ballot or our other ballot measures. So it's a good marquee issue for them. It went on by a vote of 26-12 in the Senate and 51-26 in the Assembly. I didn't look at exactly how those votes break down, but that's roughly the partisan breakdown in the Senate and the Assembly. And I imagine that's probably what you saw party line votes out. On the pro side, State Senator by the name of Ben Allen signed on, a group called Money Out Voters In, California Common Cause. State Senator Mark Leno shows up here again. The California Democratic Party is in support. On the opposition side, a state senator by the name of Jeff Stone, an assemblyman by the name of Kay Shadian, I think is how that's pronounced, and the California Republican Party. So this one probably follows the partisan breakdown more closely than most of the other ones on the ballot. There's actually a surprising number of things where the California Democratic and Republican Party agree. You see them disagree on the traditional tax and spend measures, kind of 53 through 58. And this is another one where you see a pretty clear partisan divide. So that is 59. Let's do cigarettes, unless anyone has any questions about 59. All right. Cigarettes, 56. Anyone know the current per pack tax on cigarettes? Do we have any smokers in the room? Can I call you up and put you on the spot? One? Do you know? How much does a pack of cigarettes cost these days? $6.50? Do you know how much that is taxed? So The federal government is charging you $1.01. The current state tax is 87 cents. And then you're paying sales tax, which is about 10% of the price, so about another 60 cents. So you're paying about $230, $240 in taxes total. The state excise tax is currently 87 cents. That raises about $810 million per year. So that's the current tax structure in the state. What 56 would do is increase that state excise tax by $2 per pack and provide for an equivalent increase on other tobacco products, which basically means chew and e-cigarettes, which contain nicotine. So in terms of fiscal impact, we are looking at additional state revenue of about $1 billion to $1.5 billion per year, with that probably going down in lower years as the number of people smoking declines. And the revenues would be earmarked for spending on healthcare for low-income Californians and other similar purposes. This is interesting. In 1988, about 24% of Californians smoked. It is currently about half that, about 12%. So the rate of smoking in the last almost 30 years has dropped in half. The state's revenue from our tobacco taxes similarly goes down as the number of people smoking declines, which is probably a good problem to have because it means you're saving on the healthcare costs of tobacco. But in the short term, you are collecting less tobacco taxes. So the tax on other tobacco products, which chew, chaw, those kind of things, would go to an equivalent of $3.37 per pack of cigarettes. I didn't read into it in enough detail to see how they calculate that. I'm not sure if that's one can of chew or if they figure out some metric for how a pack of cigarettes equates to a can and a half. I don't know. But it's roughly comparable. And it imposes excise taxes on e-cigarettes, which I think would be the first time. Right now, you pay sales tax on e-cigarettes, but you don't really pay tobacco taxes. So it's applied to those too. On the pro side, not a lot of surprises here. The American Cancer Society, the American Academy of Pediatrics, the American Cancer Society Action Network, the Children's Defense Fund, the American Lung Association, the American Heart Association, the California Democratic Party, the San Francisco Chronicle, and a local billionaire by the name of Tom Steyer, who you may have seen on TV and radio recently. Anyone know what I'm talking about, Tom Steyer? Been on radio and TV a lot, spending a lot of his own money laying the groundwork for a run for office. No one's quite sure yet which office that would be. It could be governor in 2018, it could be Senate if Dianne Feinstein retires. That's TBD, but if you see him on TV radio ads, that's his money that he's spending, his money that he's putting behind Props 56, and a lot of other political actions that he's doing. On the con side, there was a former executive director of the California State Board of Education, a former director of maternal health and family planning in LA, president of the Association of Orange County Deputy Sheriffs. It's not really a law enforcement issue, but you can see why Orange County would be jazzed by a tax that's pretty high. The former director of the California Department of Finance, the former executive director of the California State Board of Education, president of the National Tax Limitation Committee. So there are groups, the National Tax Limitation Committee, the Howard Jarvis, what does he call it? Howard Jarvis Center for something, something, they're against taxes. So you see those kind of groups come out in opposition to tax measures like this. And then the California Republican Party is against it. So this is one where we have the Democratic Party on one side, the Republican Party on another side. Interestingly, New York City passed recently what are called pricing minimums, meaning that in New York, you can't sell cigarettes for below a certain price. I think it's $10 or $10.50. The idea being that the more you make smoking difficult, the more impediments you put into the process of purchasing cigarettes and consuming cigarettes, the less likely children are to start smoking, and the less likely people who are kind of on the bubble are to continue smoking. So those price minimums have actually proved a pretty effective means of discouraging smoking, particularly with kids who are a lot more price sensitive, they don't have enough money. This tax approaches that in a similar way, except it generates revenue that the state uses for similar purposes, as opposed to just saying you can sell it for more loans. So, similar, there are some differences. And I'm going to go off on one aside here, point of personal privilege, because I'm working on some legislation at work that deals with the number one most littered item in the world, which is cigarette butts. There are about 5 trillion of them littered every year. They take over a decade to degrade, and I don't mean biodegrade, they don't biodegrade, because they're made out of plastic. They essentially just decompose into smaller pieces. Those pieces are filled with hundreds of different toxins and can be consumed by animals or children. In fact, about 5,000 people a year, primarily kids, are poisoned by accidentally ingesting cigarette butts. And I put one cigarette butt in a liter of water, and over the course of about a month, it turned that water brown. And we are littering about 5 trillion of those every year, the vast majority of which end up in bay and ocean. It is a serious environmental and actually public health problem, and it's sort of a corollary to the immediate health impacts of smoking. It's a more diffuse secondary impact of what happens with those cigarette butts when someone flicks them on the ground, because the vast majority of smokers do keep them on the ground. Not on the ballot, that's beside. That is the cigarette tax. Any questions on that?
Will it negatively affect small business owners whose business plan is primarily based around liquor and cigarette sales?
It could, to the extent it reduces overall cigarette consumption, it could. It doesn't disadvantage one group over the other because the tax is applied to every vendor. But yes, to the extent you are depressing the market for purchasing cigarettes overall, theoretically, yes. I can go on that point. I probably shouldn't, but I don't think those grocers make a significant portion of the profits from these products. Some people may disagree with that. All right, we've got about 7 left. How are we doing on time?
You're good.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, did I gloss over that a little too quickly? Where are we, 56? It mostly goes to state health programs, so medical programs and also tobacco control, so smoking cessation programs, smoking prevention programs. I didn't put the breakdown of how specifically the money spent. There is some, I think it was around $100 million that goes into sort of oversight and administration, but the vast majority of the revenue goes towards those health programs. And I think it was around $1 billion that goes specifically towards the health side. It's in the ballot, but there's a nice little graph. I want to do 53, because that's an interesting one that is more nuanced than it may seem. So, 53 requires statewide voter approval before any revenue bonds can be issued or sold by the state for certain projects if those revenue bonds are going to exceed $2 billion. And let me explain what that means a little bit. When the state wants to finance a large project, construction of a bridge or a highway or a high-speed train, they often sell bonds. And there are 2 basic different types of bonds. They are called what are called general obligation bonds, and there are revenue bonds. General obligation bonds are required to go on the ballot. They require 2/3 voter approval. And it's sort of like buying a mortgage. The state goes out and sells these bonds. They get the money up front. They pay it back in yearly installments over the course of 10, 20, 30 years. So your $1 million bridge is financed with GO bonds over the next 25 years. You pay a total of about $2 billion in principal and interest to pay for your bridge. Once you get the money now, you get the bridge. Those are GO bonds. The other popular type of bond is called a revenue bond, where you know that you're going to be making money off of something over the next 30 years. So you actually borrow against that money that you're going to be making. And in San Francisco, our public transit system, MUTE, has the authority to issue revenue bonds, because they know that they're going to be collecting fares for the next 20 years. So they can actually borrow against those known future earnings. pay for capital projects now. And those are called revenue bonds. So currently, the state goes to the voters for GO bonds, is not obligated to go to the state for revenue bonds. What Prop 53 does is it says, if the state is going to sell revenue bonds, if the state is going to sell revenue bonds for projects that are going to cost over $2 billion, and this is the state selling those bonds as opposed to a city, a county, a school district, or a community college district, then the state will have to go for statewide voter approval for those bonds. Now, in terms of fiscal impact and how this will play out, it is a little bit difficult to anticipate because there are some ways that the state government can react rather than going to the ballot. They could replace the large projects, say your bridge, with a few smaller projects like roads that go around the canyon. They could perform other activities that would reduce the need for the project. So shore up the bridge that's already there for a price less than $2 billion rather than replacing one with one that's newer, potentially safer. Or they could find other ways to pay for the project rather than pursuing those revenue bonds. So it's difficult to anticipate how this will play out. In terms of who supports and who opposes, what's interesting on the opposition side is that you see a lot of people involved with emergency response. So the California Professional Firefighters, the State Sheriff's Association, the California Water Agencies, the Hospital Association, the California Office of Emergency Services, the California Firefighters, I think I already said. So you see a lot of people who are on the emergency side of government. And then, of course, the League of California Cities, the California Chamber of Commerce, the Democratic Party, and that's essentially it on the con side. The reason why you're seeing those emergency responders and emergency entities in opposition to this is because they are concerned it slows down the state's capacity to respond to infrastructure emergencies quickly. So if a dam breaks and we need to pay to replace it immediately or people are going to get flooded, the state's not going to have time to wait for the next ballot or call a special election and get two-thirds voter approval for the revenue bond to pay for that. When about 8 or 9 years ago, a truck overturned on a 580 overpass and melted the overpass such that you couldn't get on the Bay Bridge, the state's not going to have time to go out to the voters and get approval for a revenue bond to pay for the replacement of that. They need to just do it immediately. I don't think that project is $2 billion, but it's a decent local example. So that's the concern that we see from the first responder side and the infrastructure side is what happens if we're presented with an emergency infrastructure situation and we don't have time to go through this voter approval process. On the pro side, the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, that's the name of the group, a Contra Costa supervisor, a retired California Highway Patrol commissioner, and the Republican Party. The Republican Party in San Francisco doesn't have a lot of say in what happens in Sacramento because they are vastly outnumbered. They're about a third of their elected representatives in the state legislature. So you can imagine why they would prefer to see more things go to the ballot, particularly on tax issues, so that they can have a larger say in the process. Whereas in Sacramento, a lot of times, these may just get approved regardless of what the Republicans have. 53 is an interesting one, and I will tell you from my own local experience, San Francisco voters gave Muni the authority to issue revenue bonds, but they did not require Muni to go to the voters every time they do it. The Public Utilities Commission in San Francisco, which manages our water and power, also has the authority to sell revenue bonds, but the voters do not expect them to go back to the voters every time they want to do it. We do go to the voters with general obligation bonds, I think, because required to interstate law. Yes?
Two-part question. First part, that scenario that you explained about the freeway and the melting and what have you, would the state get revenue bonds for that? Because how is the freeway going to generate revenue?
I was looking for a local example, probably not on that specific one. If it was something like the Golden Gate, which is managed by interconnection, I need a better example here. Something that's going to generate revenue, a bridge, owned and operated. by the state a couple months ago, that's going to generate revenue from tolls. You could do it through revenue.
So the second part of my question is, earlier you said that this only applies to state, not city or county or whatever. Yes. So should a situation like that truck arise, couldn't the county just take care of it and override this whole system?
Probably not. In a situation like that, it's property of the state. Caltrans is the responding agency. It would be pretty difficult for them to like transfer ownership to circumvent this requirement. They would probably come up with some other funding mechanism than revenue laws, would be my guess. But there, you reminded me of a point that I wanted to make, which is that a lot of the impetus behind Prop 53 has to do with the high-speed rail project, which voters originally approved in 2006, I think, at a then anticipated cost of, I'm making up numbers here, around $8 billion. It's since gone up 6 or 7x, and there's a lot of sentiment that that project has become a boondoggle and that voters should have a say before we sell bonds like this over and over again at increasingly high dollar amounts. So that's some of the background behind Prop 53, is this idea that the state is abusing the revenue bond model. Did you? Yeah.
And then, wasn't there, I know back in the day, they wanted to put in a canal to carry water from the Sacramento and San Joaquin rivers to LA. And the new plan is to build a tunnel and send the water down through the tunnel. And maybe people want that to happen.
Yeah. Yeah, that's actually a good example of another project that probably was some of the motivation behind Prop 53. Is that right? I don't know that tunnel well. Did I mention at the beginning that I work in local politics and not state politics, but for some reason got dragged here to do state issues? I would love to talk about the 25 ballot measures in San Francisco. But yeah, that is a good example. I just don't know that well. I don't know that water tunnel that well. All right, that's 53. So we're left with school bonds, the Medi-Cal hospital fee, the legislature's proceedings, criminal sentences and parole, and English proficiency.
Why don't you pick
anybody
one?
Have any interest in any of those particular ones?
The
Fox
57, criminal.
57, okay, let's do it. 57 allows parole consideration for persons convicted of nonviolent felonies upon completion of prison term for their primary offense. So you can be paroled more easily for nonviolent felonies, is essentially the interpretation of that. It authorizes the Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation to award sentence credits for rehabilitation, good behavior, or educational achievements. Essentially, you can shorten your sentence if you are getting educated, behaving in jail, pursuing rehabilitation. And it requires the Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation to adopt regulations to implement new parole and sentence credit provisions. So that's just sort of the procedural process for doing the second thing. And the other one that's interesting about this is it requires that juvenile court judges make the determination about whether or not a juvenile should be tried as an adult. So are people familiar with that process? Currently, if you are a juvenile, you could be charged either as a juvenile or as an adult, and the determination about whether or not you are charged as a juvenile or an adult can be based on, can be done via three different methods. Either there is something that is in the statute that automatically says, if you're being charged with this crime, it is serious enough that we're going to charge you as an adult. Or it can be done at the discretion of the prosecutor based on the crime and your criminal history, or it can be done at the discretion of the judge at a hearing. So what 57 does is it says we're going to get rid of the first two of those. It can't be done just because of the nature of the crime you're being charged with, and it can't be done at the discretion of the prosecutor. You can only be charged as an adult if a judge in juvenile court says so. And the significance of this is, if you're tried as an adult, the sentencing, the criminal prosecution process is going to be much more punitive than if you were tried as a juvenile. So what this is saying is let's have that discretion rest with the judge in juvenile court as opposed to with the prosecutor, or not having discretion at all and just having it codified in the law. So that's the last and I think most interesting provision of 57, but obviously the other element of it is that it makes it easier to get paroled for non-violent felonies.
Do they have, so in that, do they have like set funds to go towards setting that up? Like, towards that happening? Or is it just where they can go to be like, okay?
I'm sorry, set funding?
Sorry, yeah, is it like, what are we voting just to say that, yeah, this can happen? Or let's put money to make this happen?
So you are voting to say, I'm paraphrasing, should it be easier to get paroled for a nonviolent felon if you are getting educated, behaving well, and pursuing rehabilitation? Yeah, that's one. And should it be harder for a juvenile to be tried by an adult, and should we make it so that only a juvenile judge makes that decision? So that's the decision before you with Prop 57. In terms of fiscal impact, you're looking at savings in what they call the tens of millions of dollars annually, largely because you will be paroling people earlier and imprisoning them for shorter periods of time and keeping people in jail is very expensive. Yes, ma'am?
Sorry to ask you this question, but why are they lumped together? What if one person had different views on the two things and they're lumped together?
Yeah, at the Board of Supervisors in the city, we have what's called dividing the question, where if a piece of legislation like this comes up, you can say, I'd like to divide the question, vote one way on one piece and one way on another piece. Ultimately, then it gets put back together into one piece of legislation you have to vote on. So you have to make a decision, you know, am I so opposed to this one that it outweighs my support for this one? And that's the decision that you're faced with here. I would speculate that they included the juvenile part of it because that's popular and it made it more likely to pass the roll call. But I wouldn't speculate.
Is this an attempt to chip away at two strikes and you're out?
Potentially, yeah. I mean, it's an attempt to diminish the number of people that we have incarcerated and the amount of time that they spend incarcerated.
Yeah.
It's similar to Prop 47 that we saw in 2014, which redefined a lot of offenses as misdemeanors rather than offenses that operated in between misdemeanors and felonies. All right, English proficiency,
question.
Legislative proceedings, hospital fee, school bonds.
Yeah, question.
Are there any commercial organizations for the previous things?
Oh, I didn't do the pro and con, did I? Let's do that. Pro, the lead proponent for this one is Jerry Brown, Governor Jerry Brown, who signed some mandatory sentencing regulations in the law when he was governor the first time around, before most of the kids in this room were born, actually before I was born. And so he's the lead proponent on 57. Also, Chief Probation Officer, the President of Probation Officers of California, the widow of a police officer who was killed in the line of duty, the California Democratic Party, San Francisco Chronicle. On the con side, there's a retired judge, a sheriff in Orange County, the founder of Memory of Victims Everywhere, Marty Halloran, who was the president of the San Francisco Police Officers Association, the president of the Association of Los Angeles Deputy Sheriffs, the president of the California District Attorneys Association, and the California Republican Party. So you see a lot of the law and order types in opposition.
Do you have any evidence that there's sort of covert channels from given the commercialization of criminology in the last 7 decades flowing into against that proposition?
I don't know. It'd be an easy thing to find out.
Fair enough. Yes,
yeah, you can look it up on the FPC PBC. All right, let's do one more and then I want to vote. And I've got poll results for you too. School bonds are boring. Hospital fee is kind of boring. Let's do English proficiency. That's a good government one. So, in 1998, California voters passed Prop 227, which was passed in the context of a lot of concern about largely Spanish-speaking Latinos overtaking our public education system. There was a lot of that sentiment. I remember this. There was a lot of that sentiment fomented in the late 90s with Prop 227 and with Prop 187, which denied access to government services if you were not an American citizen. So this is, Prop 227 was sort of a product of that era. And what it did is it required English learners, so kids who are learning the English language, to be taught in English, and it restricted the use of bilingual education. So parents of those kids, the parents whose kids are learning English, under Prop 227 have to come to the school and sign a waiver if they want their child to be considered for bilingual education. Now you can imagine if a child in California is learning English, the parents probably don't speak it either. So you're putting this requirement on the parents that they come to the school, sign this waiver, ask for their kids to be taught in the language they actually understand, and the school can approve that request only if the kids have attended an English-only classroom for at least 30 days, and their teacher, principal, and district superintendent all agree that they should have bilingual education, or the students are at least 10 years old, or the students are already fluent English speakers. So since 1998, fewer schools have offered bilingual programs than prior to Prop 227. Now, what Prop 58 does is it preserves the requirement that public schools ensure students obtain English language proficiency. In other words, it's a complicated way of saying schools still have to make sure that kids learn English. It requires school districts to solicit parent community input in developing language acquisition programs. That's just sort of a feel-good way of saying that there will be parent community input. It requires instruction to ensure that kids are learning English as rapidly and effectively as possible, are the adjectives that they use. And this is the one that actually changes something. The other three are sort of defensive. It authorizes school districts to establish dual language immersion programs for both native and non-native speaking English speakers. So if you have a kid who born, raised here, speaks English, you speak English, but you want them in a bilingual education program so that he can be bilingual when he's an adult, your school district will be able to provide that. And if you don't speak English, if your kid doesn't speak English, the school district will be able to provide you with dual language immersion programs so that they are being taught both in their native language and in English. And I imagine there's probably some degree of different schools of thought about whether it's more effective to put the Spanish-speaking kid in an English-only environment and just wait for him to figure it out, or whether it's better to put a Spanish-speaking kid in an environment where he's speaking both Spanish and English and he has the opportunity to learn both, or to use Spanish as a bridge to learn English. My own opinion is that the second one would be better. The voters in 1998 lean more towards the first one, and with Prop 58, we would go more towards the dual bilingual track. Yes? No, I'm just using Spanish as an example because a lot of the political dialogue around this in the mid to late 90s was particularly about Latino immigrants speaking Spanish. But no, it applies to everybody.
So voting yes would vote for the dual
more bilingual education. Yes.
One of the things that we found was that the students say they were learning science in their home language at the same time that they were learning to speak English in another class. Then once they had the command of English, they would also have the science in English. And so that, but if you're only teaching them the science in English, they don't understand.
Yeah.
Then it just never gets
harder. Yeah. That's a really good point. That's a Okay, so on the pro side for this one, the California Federation of Teachers, and in some cases I'm naming the groups when it was the senior vice president, I suspect he's speaking on behalf of the entire organization. California Federation of Teachers, the California School Boards Association, the California Language Teachers Association, that's not very surprising, the president of the California State PTA, Tom Torlakson, who is the state superintendent of public instruction, that's a statewide elected position, kind of like a superintendent, but at the state level. Tom Torlakson signed a lot of ballot arguments this year. I think I saw him on 3. I don't know if he's running for something, but typically when a politician shows up on a lot of ballot arguments, they're trying to boost their name, I mean. The Association of California School Administrators, the Chronicle, the California Democratic Party, and Jerry Brown are all in favor. On the con side, you have an assemblywoman from Bakersfield. Now, for those of you who aren't acquainted with lovely Bakersfield, it is probably the strongest bastion of conservatism in California. So to see an assemblywoman there in opposition to this is not surprising. A state senator from San Diego County, the chairman of a group called English for the Children, the former superintendent of Oceanside Unified School District, and the California Republican Party. And again, at the risk of interjecting too many of my own opinions, I don't think the California Republican Party is doing itself any favors with outreach to the Latino community in this state by opposing things like this. And that, and the backlash that you saw in the wake of things like Prop 227, Prop 187 in the 90s, is largely what has crippled the California Republican Party, is the inability to reach out to communities of color who now represent a majority of the state. California is actually a majority minority state, and a party that cannot appeal to minority groups and minority communities is going to have a hard time legislating or getting elected. Okay, we're going to skip school bonds, Medi-Cal, the legislature. Actually, let me do the legislature really quick.
Can we play a trivia game real fast?
What's that? Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. So,
because we're running yeah. A little bit long. Didn't you want to do some vote thing?
Yeah, are we long?
Yeah, we're long.
All right, skip it. 54, blah, blah, blah. Stuff's going to happen. Okay. Where did they go? Okay, so we didn't do 51, we didn't do 52. 53. So 53 says that the state should have to get statewide voter approval before selling revenue bonds for more than $2 billion.
Are you talking about
that one? I don't, who is in favor of that idea?
Oh, are you talking about 53?
We're going to vote. We're voting.
Oh, we're voting.
Yeah. Exercise of democracy.
Got it.
Tell us which one you're voting.
53.
Okay.
53 requires statewide voter approval for the state to sell $2 billion or more in revenue bonds.
So if you're for it, raise your hand. Is that what you're saying?
There is going to be a test on November 8th. So
right.
Is anybody in support of that idea?
I feel like I'm
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Anybody in opposition? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 10, 11, 12. 14. All right, this side of the room is very quiet. Okay, all right. We're going to call that 6 to 12. So Prop 53 is going to fail the college of current election.
And that
54
counts.
We didn't do. Oh, no, we didn't. 55 is new. Mm-hmm. Adding a $2 per pack excise tax to cigarettes, a commensurate increase in taxes to chewing tobacco and e-cigarettes, and directing the majority of that revenue to health programs. Who is in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Who is opposed? 1, 2, 3. Revising criminal sentences to make it easier to get parole for nonviolent felonies and to make it so that only judges can decide whether or not a juvenile is tried as an adult. Who is in favor of that idea? Good? Okay. Yeah. So this is to make it easier to get parole for nonviolent felonies and to make it so that juveniles can only be tried as an adult if a judge says 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, I get you 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. Who is against that? That's a clean sweep. Okay. I'm going to paraphrase, making it easier to implement bilingual education. Who is in favor of making it easier to have bilingual education? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. Who's against? Okay. There actually are schools in the San Francisco School District that do Chinese immersion. So we have these high school kids. This was one particular high school senior girl, a mom girl, and we would set her, she was volunteering for campaigns, we would set her up with a cell phone and have her call households that only speak Mandarin. And this 17-year-old blonde high school girl was speaking perfect Mandarin to voters in their native language because she was in an immersion school her entire childhood. It's amazing. It really makes me question my own parents' decision to not put me in such a program.
I failed in so many ways.
Yes. 59. So putting the state on record saying we want a constitutional amendment to get rid of Citizens United, which was the Supreme Court case saying you can spend however much you want. So a yes vote means you want us to be in opposition to Citizens United. You want us to pursue an amendment to the Constitution. Who is in favor of that idea? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Is anyone against? Anybody against? Bias. Who's against? 1, 2. Can I ask you why you're against? Who's that from? Really? Yeah, I mean, it's never going to happen, right? We're not going to pass a constitutional amendment, but working to elect a Democratic president and changing the composition of the Supreme Court, it actually could happen. All right, condoms and porn. Who wants a stronger requirement for condoms and porn and the right to sue the porn star of your choosing? Who's in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, who's against? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. All right, condoms and porn goes down. Almost there. State prescription drug purchases. So who wants to say that the state cannot pay more for drugs than the VA pays for those drugs? No, we may not know what that is. Yes means the state will not pay more than the VA pays for those drugs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Who's opposed? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That's a tie. I'm gonna break the tie. No. That one loses. Death penalty. There's nothing particularly new about these, so you either oppose the death penalty or not. Firearms. Who wants to provide stronger regulations on who and how you can purchase ammunition in the same way that we do with guns? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 6. Anybody against? 1. 2. I have a feeling you might. Marijuana legalization. Do you remember what we're talking about?
Yes. Marijuana. If you don't, then you're voting yes, right?
But I'm hungry.
If you don't know why I'm here or where we are, probably want to vote yes. Marijuana legalization. Who is in favor? favor? Okay, who is it against? Well, we're going to call out one to everybody else. Unless I miss it. Okay, Prop 65. This says that the 10 cents the grocers collect for your carry-out bag has to go to an environmental protection fund instead of staying with the grocers. What's that? Say that again?
Where the money goes?
That environmental fund will be yes.
Yeah, it's like a wild, it doesn't, it's not.
One,
a
two, yeah.
I don't
so want the 10 cents to go to this undefined environmental. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18.
Did we do 62?
No, I skipped 62 because either you're for the death penalty or you're not, so.
Okay.
Not that interesting.
Pretty
straightforward. Okay, and who is against this? Taking the 10 cents and making it go to the as yet undefined environmental. One, two, three, four. Wow. So I'll tell you, I'm kind of amazed that the California Grocers Association isn't running a stronger campaign against this thing. I think it probably will pass, and I think it's actually harmful to the environment if it does, because it accomplishes, well, I'm editorializing a lot here, it accomplishes what the plastic bag industry set out to do, which is divide the coalition of people who support it. Say, love you. 66, the death penalty one again, whatever. 67, and I'm not going to repeat this too many times because voters are going to be presented with a confusing choice. Do you support, well, I'm just seeing if I have to say it that way, it's not that confusing. Do you want to uphold California's ban on disposable plastic bags? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, do you not want to? You don't? I see, that's the thing. I don't want to say it again because this thing is designed to confuse people. It confuses me. So, based on what I said, how are you going to vote? Well, normally I would say when in doubt, vote no, but in this case, voting yes means you want to keep the plastic bag. All right. Okay. So, polling on statewide propositions is difficult to attempt to acquire and often unreliable because the only people who really have it, who have good polling data, are the campaigns and the political action campaign committees that are involved with the campaigns. So, publicly available polling is difficult. I found one that's sort of a poll of polls. You have to take it with a grain of salt because I think a lot of people haven't studied these yet, blah, blah, blah. These polls aren't that extensive. But we went no on Prop 53, the revenue bond thing. That is currently polling 43 yes, 19 no, 38 undecided. We went strongly yes on the cigarette tax. That's currently polling 67 yes, 14 no, 18 undecided. So that's going to pass. We went unanimously yes on the criminal sentences one, making it easier to get parole and changing it for juveniles. That's at 70 yes, 12 no, 18 undecided. So that's almost certainly going to pass. The bilingual one, this is kind of surprising, is at 42% yes, 25% no, 33% undecided. The Citizens United one, we went 11 yes, 2 no, is at 40% yes, 38% no, 22% undecided. So what I said earlier about this driving turnout and getting people excited may not be true. It looks like people don't really care. So maybe I'll go. Adult condoms and porn, we went 5 yes, 12 no. It's currently at 42% yes, 18% no, 40% undecided. So that would be great in either direction, late, but it's kind of leaning towards yes, which is concerning for the San Fernando Valley. The prescription drug one, we went 9 to 10. 45% yes, 38% no, 17% undecided. The death penalty, abolishing the death penalty, this seems out of line. I actually question this accuracy, but is at 62% yes for abolishing the death penalty, 26% no, 12% undecided. I don't think it's going to be anywhere near that top 7, but we'll see. The firearms one, the ammunition, we went 26 to 2 yes, It's at 60% yes, 30% no, 10% undecided. Marijuana is surprisingly close at 49% yes, 32% no, 19% undecided. There actually was a marijuana legalization measure probably 22, I want to say, several years ago that failed. Prop 65, the taking the 10 cents from the bags and giving it to the environmental purpose, is at 32% yes, 21% no, 47% undecided. I think it's probably confusing people. The death penalty one that I didn't talk about this, but 66 basically just makes it easier to put someone to death, is at 49% yes, 36% no, 15% undecided. So that was leaning towards yes too. And then the plastic bag referendum is at 55% yes. In other words, 55% of people want to continue the plastic bag ban. 25% no, 20% undecided. And again, take those with a grain of salt. But I do think you can kind of get a sense of where these are going to break. A lot of them are going to pass. Some of them are in more trouble. The cigarette taxes ones for sure. Those are going to get more expensive. Any last minute questions before I steal some of your food in the back?
What happens when if the death penalty appeal passes and the death penalty procedures pass?
Yeah, I was in the process of reading that on the Googles today, and then I got a phone call or something and didn't read it. But in San Francisco, when that happens, and it happens a lot, we get competing ballot measures, the one that gets more votes prevails.
Okay.
I don't know if that's what they're going to do.
I think that's what happened the last time.
Death penalty.
That there was a death penalty issue on the ballot. There wound up being two.
Yeah.
And so the one with the most votes prevailed, so we still have the death
penalty. Yeah, I imagine that's what the state does, but I don't know how else you can do it. And so what happens in San Francisco is somebody puts something on the ballot, and somebody else puts something very similar, but with what's called a kill switch, to kill the other person.
Mm-hmm.
And all you have to do is get more votes than them. I actually wrote one of these last year. And so we got more votes than the beat there. That happens. Any other?
What was it?
That was for clean energy. It was 2015's Prop H. And we were running against Prop I. So we were yes on H, no on I. But it was a long story. We ended up negotiating with them, so they supported all of us. Interesting story for another time. What happened is we put a provision in ours that embarrassed them, that they didn't want people talking about. And they were, how can we make this go away? We can read yours, take that provision out, and we'll support it.
Caitlin's going to do three questions.
Yes, sir.
What do you think are some, well, what is the most pertinent issue to the district that you analyze policy for?
Say that again?
What is the most pertinent issue in front of you right now? I mean, which one do you care about most? In terms of, you know, changing the course of California's future.
From a fiscal perspective, the cigarette tax, 57 criminal sentences, and marijuana have the opportunity to help the budget the most. School bonds are certainly important, and those are investments that pay off. Those tend to pass. So probably the big ticket financial ones are typically the most important. You know, the death penalty gets a lot of press and a lot of attention, but ultimately doesn't impact that many people and can suck the oxygen out of the room for conversations about other important issues. I don't think condoms and porn are the pressing issues. I'll tell you that. I do think the plastic bag ban is really important environmentally. We are a state defined by our proximity to water, particularly here in the Bay Area. And this and cigarette butts and styrofoam, which we just recently banned in San Francisco, are some of the biggest pollutants to our water. So that's important, for sure. Anybody else?
Quickly define what bonds are.
I did.
About bonds and bonds. What do you mean?
Yeah, I did a little bit. I mean, a bond is, it's like a mortgage. You're going out and saying, I need to raise $1 billion. Who wants to give it to me? I promise to pay you back over the next 10, 20, 30 years. And similarly to a mortgage, you're going to end up spending about as much in interest as you did in capital, the project itself. So if you ask for $1 billion, you're probably going to end up spending $2 billion over the life of the bond. But you are buying debt, right? And you're doing it based on your creditworthiness, how much they trust you to pay back. So the state is has pretty good credit ratings. San Francisco has impeccable credit ratings. So we get pretty good rates on our bonds, which means our cost of borrowing is lower. So we can get more principal relative to the total cost. We can do more because credit ratings. That's one of those boring things that people don't really think about. Credit ratings matter in real terms. What projects you can undertake, how much you can do, because it impacts how much you can borrow for the cost. It's like your own personal credit rating.
Thank you, Connor.
Yeah, thank you. Go eat, Connor, if you want.
Okay, guys, so stick around for a second. We are going to do a quick round of Jeopardy and give away three gift cards. I just have to.
Hand goes up first when
they're. You have to tell me which hand goes up first because I won't be with you. Alrighty, so I was at 25, so instead I have to know our words. This proposition has no legal effect, but would advise California's elected officials to use their authority to try to overturn the Supreme Court ruling of Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission.
Thank you.
This is Jeopardy! Why
it's okay. You don't have to put. You have to tell them. You have to put it. Say what is Jeffrey? Say what is it?
All right. Yeah, of course. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, you're welcome. Did you get in? That's it.
Yeah, I got some. I just
How
want
about a
pineapple.
Lemon bar from over there?
Okay.
They're so cool.
All right. All right. 25, 15, or 10. 25 again.
Yeah,
okay, so we'll let Nathan get prepared, because
if you want to be considered, you got to be where Nathan can see your hand go up, you guys. It's good prizes. It's not just a red, white, and blue pen that I'm making fun of.
We will get you your back, and we will get you your gift card. So for the next $25 gift card question, which state proposition am I? That is correct. I am proposition 64.
Here in Marin County, we have 27 different ballot types. So we have local measures. We measure G in Novato. If you're Republican, you get one ballot time. If you're Democrat, you get another ballot time. So if you live in Southern Marin, if you live in San Anselmo, all different ballot types for every different city. And then if you're Libertarian, if you're Republican, if you're Democrat, they're all different ballot types. So make sure that you see your ballot type 01 that we have over here, which is here in this area. So I want to touch base with you. The recommendation that we gave you was from the League of Women Voters. We didn't study everything. We only took the time to study those positions that we really found that were most important. And especially when it comes to Citizens United, it was a recommendation. So we didn't, the League didn't take a position because they didn't think that it was effective enough. They thought that it was too loose and they wanted something with a little bit more impact. So basically all it was just the state of California residents lobby. So we come to the legislature as lobbyists saying, we want you to vote for us, you are our legislature, so do this, and we're very clear and specific. So it just depends on how you feel that we can make effective change with that proposition or not. The Easy Voter Guides are from the League of Women Voters, and they have all of the 17 ballot propositions laid out for you in short pros and cons. I know we didn't go over everything, and I know you may still have some questions. So these guides, these red, white, and blue guides, will give you everything that you need to go. And those are nonpartisan, unbiased information. Here at the League, here in Marin County, we have a justice committee that studies social justice issues. So we'd love to come back another time and talk to you about that a little bit further. So here in Marin County, we have a high number of people who are registered voters. So in the last election, we had 89% of our population were of the registered voters. Those eligible, those were registered, showed up with and voted on election day. But since then, we found that there were 20,000 people who were eligible to vote, but still not registered. So it was important for us to go out, and especially with the youth population, and register everyone that we could find. And it was interesting that we had some interesting, strange bedfellows. We had the interfaith community going out and registering voters. We had the student union, the ESCOM here at College of Marin, as well as the Democrats and Republicans were all going out to register voters because it was all about civic participation. And the whole idea is for you to get involved in some way, shape, or form. So you don't have to be at the microphone where I am or talking like the last speaker, but you can read the paper, you can talk to people, you can look on the internet. And so the way that I got information when I was in college, and I was a student here at College of Marin and IBC, we had hard copy newspapers. And so we panned through the newspapers, but now you have the opportunity of seeing so many different opinions online. So you have a greater advantage to see a broad spectrum of voices and make your own decisions. So you have a much bigger advantage than we did. And you not only could read the paper, you could talk to your community, you could be an influencer and be a speaker in class, you could take a boards and commissions training. And I know there are classes that prepare you to get involved in your community. So at the county level, we have the youth and youth commission that you can be involved in up to the age of 23 years old. And that's a county position. And all you have to do is apply, go online to the Marin County, marincounty.org, and look for boards and commissions. And so there are all types of different boards and commissions that you can get involved in. So you could be on the Youth Commission, you could also be on the Multicultural Commission, you could be on any commission that piques an interest to you. So those are up for grabs, and they're motivated and propelled by the citizens here in Marin County. So it's important for you to get involved any way, shape, and form that you can. So basically it's just staying involved, being out there, reading the paper, using your opinion, talking to friends, and don't be afraid to make those comments online. But when you make those comments, make sure that they are well thought out and not just comments off the top of your head, emotionally driven.
So that's what takes us back as a community, in my opinion, is when we're too emotionally driven and we don't think through an argument. So lay out the arguments so people can be informed. Here in Marin County, we have one countywide measure, and that's Measure A. It's preschool for all. It's a 0.25 sales tax that will give underserved kids preschool. So we will take a couple million dollars a year and give it to any underserved, underadvantaged children for early preschool education. And the big thing about that is they say that kids who have preschool education are more motivated when they're in grade school, and then they're more engaged in middle school, they're more engaged in college, and they're more likely to be voters. And if you vote in 3 elections consecutively, you will be a lifetime voter. So I want you to make sure that your voter status is updated every time you move, or if you change your name, you have to update your voter status, because your ballot will not follow you. How many people are vote by mail? Okay, about a third of us are vote by mail, and the rest of us will go to our polling place. Do you know where your polling place is? Okay, so your sample ballot comes to you, and your polling place is listed right on the back, so you can find out where that is. If you're a vote by mail person, you get your ballot a month in advance, you can study it, and you can also engage in the process by taking it to any polling place and dropping it in the machine. So you can still participate and get your sticker and wear it all day long, but you can take it to the polling place. So if you're a vote by mail person, make sure that you sign the envelope and that you sign the ballot, and once the ballots go to the elections department, they are immediately separated from the envelopes and put into separate piles. And then the computer scans your signature 3 different times. It scans your ballot. First they scan your name, and then they scan the envelope, and then they scan the signature on the ballot. So we always make sure that ballot is indeed from that one person. If you make sure that when you register to vote, that you have your name written the way that you like to be addressed. So if you want to be Susie, or if you want to be
Mary Jane, make sure to put that on there. Time's up, huh? I lost my microphone.
Oh, no. Time is up. Time is up. So in the last few words, the elections department is always looking for people to work at the polling place. And you can find a partner and work half days, or you can work all 10 hours. You earn about $125 a day. And it's great to see the process from the inside. Even if you just do it once, it's really fun. So you can find a partner and do it for 6 hours, do the same job, or you can do it for 10 hours. Another fun thing that you can do is you can go to the elections department after 8 p.m. and be an observer and watch the ballots come in. So at the polling places, the ballots and the ballot boxes are escorted by the sheriffs. And it's interesting that usually the first one to come in is out in West Marin. That's because they have the fewest number of people and they can shut it down quickly. And they're escorted by the sheriff's department, and then they enter the bowels of the civic center where there's a card inside, a machine, and then there's the paper ballot. So we always have 2 different forms of the same vote. So if the ballots are destroyed and there's some sort of problem, we've got the card. If there's a problem with the card, we've got the paper ballots and we run them through the machine again. So we do copy the ballots as soon as they come in, and we've got them on that card. And then the cards are escorted by 2 different people upstairs, and then they're read by 1 specific machine. And all of the voting machines are certified by federal standards. And our voting machines are sort of falling apart, and it would make great sense for us just to make them with 3D computers and make the parts, but they're not certified. So now we're in the process of looking for certified election material. A lot of people wonder if we'll ever vote online, and it seems very doubtful because there's too many opportunities for fraud along the way. Some countries like Astoria, they vote online, and some countries such as China, they don't vote at all. So it's really fun, and some countries such as Kyrgyzstan, they have a very elaborate opportunity for voting, and they go house by house, and they take the ballot box to you, and they have your thumbprint, and they watch you while you vote, and then you take your time and vote, and then they go to the next house. So everyone has the opportunity to vote, and it makes it much easier. In some countries, it's a holiday, so that's what I'm all in favor for. And here in California, we have a voter motor. You may have heard of that. So next year, next July, every time that you register your car, you will automatically be registered to vote. And it will be an opt-out system. So people who don't want to engage in the civic engagement, they have to opt out of the system. So over the course of this last year, we had about 8,000 voter registrations. So after the June election, in 2014, we had 21,000 people who were eligible to vote who were not registered, and we registered about 7,000 people within this last year. So it'll be fun to find the election results, because we've been all watching this for the last 2 years. And if you're like me, I'm starting to get a little voter fatigue. I'm happy when it's over. And in January, the League of Women Voters actually has Mindy Romero, who you saw in the video from the Center of Civic Engagement, who's going to talk to us about the youth vote, and that'll be on January the 9th. I know it'll be midterm for you, but you're always invited to come, and we'll give that information to you if you'd like to join us for that presentation. So I'm looking forward to finding out the results of the election, as are you, and don't forget to vote. And if you vote by mail, make sure that your ballot is postmarked, or you can take it to the elections office. And I hope that you take the opportunity to go to the Civic Center and really walk into the elections department, or if you've got nothing to do after 8 p.m. on Tuesday night, go and be an observer and just check out the process and sign up, and they'll take you downstairs and you can see the process and how it works. It's great for kids and really a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And I'm Vita Flores, and I'm the communications consultant for the elections department, and I'm also on the voter service committee for the League of Women Voters. And by the way, the League of Women Voters has about 20% men, so you're welcome to join us in our fight for democracy. Okay, thanks everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah, how do you move over these? Switch up. Caitlin.
Thank you very much.
Ask her.
Caitlin, is this one yours?
It was over here.
What's that?
Switch up.